Hello everyone, myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So today we are going to discuss a lot of interesting questions like fair and remunerative price on sugarcane. So we will be learning what it is and how is it going to benefit the farmers. Also, we will be discussing about the coastline erosion as well as expansion. So recently a report has been released related to that, along with a new report that Asian Development Bank has released in relation to Asia. So all of this, in addition to the recommendations that NS Vishwanathan Committee of the RBI has recently proposed to RBI. So all of these things we are going to discuss in this video only. So this is going to be a very beneficial as well as comprehensive video for you. So let's begin. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. And this is the video that you can use for RBI, SEBI and NABARD examinations. Guys, before moving ahead, if you haven't subscribed our channel, then do so at the earliest, because this is going to give you the notifications about the new uploads that we make on our channel. And this is the Telegram group which you can join in order to get the PDF of this session. Okay, so the very first question that we have is about the fair and remunerative price for sugar cane. So how much is the fair and remunerative price for sugar cane for the 2021 to 2022 season? So out of these many options, the right answer is Rs. 290 per quintal. Here two things are important that you need to know beforehand. The first thing is that this is the highest ever FRP set by the government of India. The second point is, what is FRP? Okay, so basically central government sets MSP, minimum support price, for a total of 22 crops, and for sugarcane it sets up fair and remunerative price. So under this fair and remunerative price, basically the government of India mandates the sugar mills to purchase sugarcane from the farmers at a fixed rate, which is fair as well as remunerative to the farmers. Okay, because sugarcane can only be purchased by the mills, because it requires value addition in order to be converted into sugar. Therefore, FRP is levied on the sugar mills, whereas MSP is the direct mechanism. So through this MSP, minimum support price, the government directly purchases goods from the farmers and then it distributes the goods among the public, the agriculture goods among the public. So this MSP is levied on the government. So government purchases the agriculture goods at MSP. And this is not mandated or legally bound on any other private entity. However, FRP is legally bound on the sugar mills. That this much is the minimum price that you have to pay to the sugarcane farmers. I hope that this much is clear to you. So this is the basic crux that which we are going to read about. So basic crux to yahi hai FRP ka. Now let's understand what the government has done recently. So first thing is this only, that Rs. 290 per quintal FRP will be given to the farmers. Now this will be given if the basic recovery rate is 10%. So guys, what is the meaning of basic recovery rate? Basic recovery rate is basically the proportion of sugar that is made out of a certain quantity of sugar cane. For example, if I am a farmer, I am producing 100 kgs of sugar cane, and out of these 100 kg, the 10% of this sugar cane can be converted into sugar. Then that means 10 kg sugar I can obtain from the 100 kg worth of sugar cane. Then the MSP, sorry, the price that farmers will get for each quintal would be Rs. 290. Okay, so I hope that you have now understood what is the meaning of basic recovery rate. I'm again repeating to you, basic recovery rate means the proportion of sugar that can be produced from a certain quantity of sugar cane. Okay, so if this proportion is 10%, then the farmer will get Rs. 290 per quintal for entire production of sugarcane that he has done. But in case recovery rate is 9.5%. For example, out of this 100 kg, the quality of sugarcane is such that it can produce only 9.5 kg of sugar or less than that. Then the price, the FRP, would be Rs. 275 per quintal. Okay, I hope that this is clear to you. So this is the basic mechanism, and here only the examiner can confuse you. Okay, the next point is the cost of production of the sugar cane in 21 to 2020. So this is the estimate the government has made, is Rs. 155 per quintal, and in opposition to this production cost, the government is offering Rs. 290 per quintal. So according to the government, it is 87.1% higher than the production cost that the farmer is incurring on producing the sugar cane. Now, out of this much, out of the sugar that will be produced during the 2021 to 2022 season, this much sugar quantity will be diverted into ethanol, because we have 20% ethanol blending target by 2025. Okay. So this is something that I have already told you. 22 crops ke liye government sets MSP, and only for sugarcane it sets FRP. Okay, so this was the current news. I hope that you have understood it well. Now I am moving on to the next question. Guys, this is a very important question. RBI ne recently guidelines nikali hai, or we can say the NS Vishwanathan committee, which is the committee, expert committee on urban cooperative banks, has recently submitted its recommendation to RBI. Now, urban cooperative banks, primary cooperative banks, or what are all kinds of cooperative banks, are important for NABARD examination. So do listen to me very carefully, because these recommendations are important. The second point here is that I have taken only the major recommendations from which a question can be made in your phase 1 GA. But you need to cover these guidelines thoroughly for your phase 2 as well. And for phase 2, you can wait for RBI 247 video by Tanvi ma'am, because she will also be covering these guidelines, these recommendations in detail from the perspective of phase 2. But guys, this is the platform for phase 1 current affairs. Okay, so we will be sticking to that only. We will be sticking to the syllabus only, which requires us to cover it in a required limit of depth, in a required depth. Okay, so here we have the question: what is the minimum capital requirement for setting up an umbrella organization for cooperative banks? So what is the umbrella organization that the NS Vishwanathan committee has recommended? Because I will repeat myself here that I have taken the major recommendations. Basically, in this video, you can say you will get the crux of the recommendations of this committee. Okay, so the major recommendation was this: the setting up of an umbrella organization for urban cooperative banks. Now, what is the function of this umbrella organization, and what are the other recommendations, that we will be learning a bit later. But let's first look into the minimum capital requirement for setting up the umbrella organization. So the minimum capital requirement is 300 crores. Okay, so remember this much for the timing. Now let's look at the news. So this I have already told you, but remember that this expert committee on primary urban cooperative banks was set up in this year only. Okay, in February 2021. Now, the very first recommendation that this committee has made is this classification of UCB. So this classification is there. In tier 1, the urban cooperative banks which have deposits up to 100 crore are there. In tier 2, UCBs with deposits more than 100 crore and up to 1000 crores. So those UCBs fall under the tier 2. Tier 3, UCBs who have more than 1000 crores deposits, and the deposits, the maximum limit of deposit is 10,000 crore, and tier 4 UCBs where the deposit limit is more than 10,000 crore. So guys, here this is not the net worth limit, this is the deposit limit. Do pay attention to this as well. Okay, so the very first thing is the classification of the UCBs. So do remember this classification. Okay, on the basis of classification, the committee has recommended certain recommendations, certain prescriptions. Okay, so for each tier, you will see a certain kind of prescription given by the committee in its report. However, only the major prescriptions have been put here. Okay, the very first thing is the minimum net worth criteria that is required for the tier 1 urban cooperative banks, that is 2 crores or 5 crores. Okay, that depends upon the situation or the quality of the bank. Now, these are the different situations wherein the minimum required capital adequacy ratio will change for the urban cooperative banks. For example, in the first condition, if the minimum net worth criteria of 2 crore or 5 crore is met by the UCB and the UCB is also a member of the umbrella organization, UO means umbrella organization, then the minimum cash adequacy capital adequacy ratio that the bank has to maintain should be 9%. Capital adequacy ratio is the ratio which tells how much robust is your financial situation, how much stable are you financially. Okay, this is the ratio that tells you the capital adequacy in relation to your risk. So 9% should be the ideal ratio for the UCBs who fall in tier 1 category, who are also the members of umbrella organization. In the second category, if the UCB meets the minimum net worth criteria of 2 or 5 crores but it is not a member of umbrella organization, then it has to maintain 11.5% CRAR. In third scenario, if the UCB does not meet the minimum net worth criteria of this but it is a member of umbrella organization, then this much would be the CRAR ratio limit. And in the fourth scenario, the UCB does not meet the minimum net worth criteria as well as it is not a member of umbrella organization, then the CRAR would be 14%. So this is the ratio, this is the range of CRAR, capital adequacy ratio, that the UCBs have to maintain. Okay, the next requirement or the next recommendation that this committee has made in relation to the tier 1 urban cooperative banks is that the new branches that these banks are required to open should be in the unbanked area. Okay, and when they are going to open their new branches in the unbanked areas, their minimum capital should be 2 crores, okay, in their district of operations or adjoining districts in case of banks requiring a minimum capital of 5 crore. So basically, if you, the bank is not operating in the district only, okay, in the entire district, there is not a single branch of the bank, the minimum capital requirement is this, okay? And if the in the adjoining districts also the bank has to open its branches, then the minimum capital requirement would be 5 crore. Next is 75% of adjusted net bank credit. So this is basically saying that out of the 100% exposure, the 100% credit exposure that the UCP has made, 75% should be to the loans given for priority sector lending, given under the requirements of priority sector lending. What does this mean? The basic meaning or the basic implication of this is that urban cooperative banks have been constituted because of the requirement of rural development. The basic purpose of them is to develop the areas or develop the rural areas, okay, or different segments in the rural areas, for example, agriculture, education, etc., etc. So if the banks have given loans for such projects, then the loan would come under the PSL criteria. And this requirement is saying that the urban cooperative banks need to give 75% of their loans towards PSL criteria, priority sector lending criteria. Okay. And out of this total 100% credit exposure, 50% of the credit portfolio should be small ticket loans of rupees 25 lakh. Okay, so these are the exposure requirements for the banks, for the urban cooperative banks who fall in the tier one category. And these requirements have to be complied by the banks by March 2024. Now let's come to the tier two UCBs. So here the CRAR is 15%. Capital adequacy ratio is increased to 15%. And if the UCB is a member of urban umbrella organization, then the requirement would be 14%. It would be reduced by 1%. Again, the same requirement for exposures. 75% of the total loans should go for PSL, and 50% of them should be small ticket loans of 25 lakhs. Small ticket loans are loans which are worth 25 lakhs. Okay. Prescription for tier 3 urban cooperative banks. So here the deposits range from 1000 to 10,000 crore. So the minimum CRAR limit would be 15%, which is applicable to small finance banks as well. And PSL norms would be the same that are applicable to small finance banks. And for the tier 2 UCBs, which have more than 10,000 crore deposits, the minimum CRAR would be applicable as per the Basel III prescriptions. Okay. And PSL norms will be same as small finance banks. So these were the major recommendations of NS Vishwanathan committee. The next major recommendation is the setting up of the umbrella organization. So basically, this umbrella organization would provide the services like ID infrastructure, capital, liquidity, training to the member urban cooperative banks. Okay, and once the bank is registered with the umbrella organization, then it would become a branding. Basically, this umbrella organization would become a brand for the bank. So it will gain the trust of common public. And if the bank is successful in gaining the trust of the public, then obviously it will gather more deposits. Therefore, the responsibility of this umbrella organization is much more higher, and therefore the license should go to responsible hands. Okay, therefore the committee suggests that the grant of new license for setting up the UCBs could be considered after the UO, the umbrella organization, satisfactorily emerges as a stabilizing arrangement. So basically, after the umbrella organization has checked all the requirements that the UCB needs to fulfill, only after that the UCB will get the license. In the long run, the umbrella organization will work as a self-regulatory organization for smaller UCBs, and the minimum capital requirement is 300 crore with CRAR and regulatory framework akin to 30 to the largest segment of NBC. So basically, the CRAR and the regulatory norms that are applicable to the largest NBCs would be applicable to this umbrella organization as well. So here, this amount is very important. Do remember that. Okay, the next is resolution of UCBs if they become insolvent. So under Section 45 of the Banking Regulation Act, read with Section 56, RBI can compulsorily amalgamate or reconstruct the UCB. Now, how and in what conditions is RBI allowed to amalgamate or reconstruct the entire UCB is covered in this video. Because at this point of time, when this video was made, the guidelines related to amalgamation of urban cooperative banks came out, and they have been covered in this video thoroughly. So I would suggest you to go and watch this video after this session in order to understand the amalgamation of urban cooperative banks. So that was all about the committee's recommendation. Now let's move on to the next question. Which state witnessed the highest coastal erosion during 1990 to 2018 as per the National Center for Coastal Research data? So the right answer is West Bengal. It witnessed 60% of its coastline being eroded in the duration of 28 years. That is from 1990 to 2018. So this report is basically prepared by this National Center for Coastal Research, which comes under the Ministry of Earth Science. So this NCCR has used the satellite based data and other research technologies in order to assess the changes in the coastline over a period of 28 years. Okay, so what did it find? It found that during the 28 years period, one third of India's coastline, that is 32%, was eroded. Okay, and during the same period, 27% of the coastline expanded. Now you would be thinking that expansion and erosion is happening at the same time. So guys, whenever you are discussing a state, okay, there would be some areas which are at the higher altitude and there would be some areas which are at the lower altitude. So sea, what does the sea do? Sea basically erodes the higher altitude area and deposits that in the lower altitude area. The same phenomenon has been used, and therefore these states, the upper areas of the states have been eroded and the lower areas have been expanded. So this is how the expansion and erosion is happening at the same time. And this process has caused 32% of the coastline being eroded and 27% at the same time has been expanded. Now the states which experienced the worst effect of the erosion is West Bengal. 60% of its coastline was eroded, okay? Followed by Puducherry, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, and these are the states. Guys, do remember, Andaman and Lakshadweep have not been taken here. 9 states and 2 union territories, Puducherry and Daman and Diu, have been taken in this data, okay? The states which expanded the most are Odisha. So West Bengal is at the upper level, and then we have Odisha. So erosion and expansion is happening at the same time. Okay, so this resulted in the overall coastline of India. Remember, we are not talking about the islands. So overall coastline of India being eroded by 32% and expanding by 27%. However, this sounds a bit ridiculous, but this is the report. This is the data that we have to cover for our examination. So how much does this sound ridiculous? But you need to prepare it. You need to know this much for a fact. Okay, how much is the prevalence of undernourishment in Asia Pacific region in 2019 as per the Asian Development Bank's key indicators for Asia and the Pacific 2021 report? So basically this report assesses the social, economic and other kinds of developmental factors in Asia Pacific region. According to this report, 316 million people in the Asian Pacific region are still struggling with undernourishment. So let's see this report. This I have already told you. Now remember that ADB is 49 regional members. A total of 68 members are there, but 49 belong to Asia Pacific region. So India is also a part of this. What does this report say? This report says 75 to 80 million people in developing Asia Pacific have been pushed into extreme poverty. Extreme poverty is defined as living on less than 1.9 US dollar, which is rupees 141 a day in Indian currency. Okay, so a total of 203 million people, which constitute 5.2% of the total developing Asia's population, is living in extreme poverty. That means it is earning less than US dollar 1.9 a day. Okay, and if the COVID-19 would not have happened, then this number would have reduced to 2.6% in 2020. 71% of Asia Pacific workforce is now non-agriculture workforce, which grew from 52% between 2000 to 2019. So in 2000 it was 52%, and during this duration it has increased to 71%. And remember guys, this is the largest ever shift from agriculture to non-agriculture sector, if you see it region wise, okay, across the world. So Asia Pacific has done a tremendously good job in terms of shifting its population from agriculture to non-agriculture occupations. Prior to COVID-19 pandemic, Asia Pacific had been experiencing steady progress in SDG 3 health targets, okay, particularly on maternal and child mortality. So in terms of maternal and child mortality, the Asia Pacific region was not performing really well, And this COVID-19 situation has actually accelerated the deterioration in this SDG. The prevalence of underarrangement, we have already discussed that it is 316 million in 2019. However, it has been decreased from 521 million in 2001 to 316 million. So it is a positive factor here that undernourishment has decreased. Unemployment rates have increased by 20% in 2020 due to COVID across the globe. And in the Asia Pacific region, 8% of the working hours have been lost in July. So guys, this is supplementary. In July, Asian Development Outlook was released. So let's have a look at the GDPs that the Asian Development Bank forecasted for India. So in July, it has been reduced from 11 to 10%. Okay, do remember this thing. Now you can also see that Asian Development Bank classifies the Asia and the Pacific region into six categories: Central Asia, East Asia, South Asia, Southeast Asia, the Pacific, the Developing Asia. All these categories are geographic. However, Developing Asia is one category that is divided or that is created on the basis of economic parameters. Okay, that was an additional information that you need to know. So this is our last question of the day. Who is the winner of Stockholm Water Prize 2021? So it is Sandra Postil who has won this Stockholm Water Prize 2021. Recently, basically today is the last day of World Water Week, 23 to 27 August. So during this week that is observed by Stockholm International Water Institute, this prize was given to Sandra Postil. What is the theme of this week? Building resilience faster. So this is the theme. The World Water Week is observed in the month of August. However, dates change year by year. Okay, last year it was around 23 to 28th August or something like that was the date. And this year the date is 23 to 27 August. The theme is building resilience faster. The prize, Stockholm Water Prize, that is given by Stockholm Institute of Water, Stockholm International Water Institute, has gone to Sandra Postil for 2021. So that's all for today, guys. I hope that you have enjoyed and understood what I have taught you. Thank you so much for watching the session.